You were on 33 missions?
That's true.
Okay. You must have had some really exciting moments. Would you tell us about a few?
This program really isn't long enough because I could spend a half an hour almost on each one. They're still very vivid.
Why don't you, I know that at one point you were Pathfinder and you were flying way down in all the flak and the fire of the down below was sending your ship up and so forth. But you won some medals. I know you were eligible to win many, but why don't you tell us about the ones where you won the medals?
Well, when we flew our B-29s, if you had 100 hours of combat operational time, you got an air medal. And if you had 300 hours, you got a Distinguished Flying Cross. And so I have 644 hours accumulated on my 33 missions, so I have a few things. But the one medal, that purple thing, that is the Purple Heart, and I got that along with a couple of my buddies in the plane because we were Pathfinders on one of the early Tokyo fire raids. And a Pathfinder, again, was one of the lead crew people, and you would go out a half an hour ahead of the rest of the force. And for instance, the Pathfinders on these Tokyo missions, we would fly up to Tokyo and across Tokyo Bay and then purposely not bomb the Emperor's palace because we had high hopes that if the Emperor was strong enough to overcome the imperial warlords, the Japanese naval and army who wanted to keep going with the war, he might surrender. And so we made every effort not to damage or destroy or hurt anything around the Imperial Palace, but we could sure make targets in the rest of Tokyo. And so we flew in at about 5,000 feet, and by that time they could almost shoot at us with rifles. And so like on this mission to Tokyo as a Pathfinder, we were in the searchlights for 19 minutes, and it'd be like if you were flying from here in Cupertino up to San Francisco, you know, 1 minute you could get to Mountain View and 5 minutes maybe to Palo Alto, but 19 minutes in the searchlights and bouncing around from all the flak and shooting made it pretty rough.
We actually were. You're not shut down, but you were.
No, we were lucky because our four fans, the propellers kept going, and we had some of us wounded aboard, and my bombardier was really in bad shape. And when we contacted Iwo Jima, which we had taken by that time, to come in, and they said, hey, unless you're on two engines, you go on back to your base or ditch. And so they sent us to Guam, but we lived on Tinian, so we didn't want to go another 100 miles down to Guam, and so we decided we would land on our home base at Tinian. But unfortunately, we didn't make a smooth landing, and then we were taken from the plane over to the hospital, and then went long until we were back flying again.
You mentioned that you went on one mission the same day that the Enola Gay made its mission. Did you have any inkling that that was going on? I know that you were acquainted with the pilots.
I really never met General Tibbetts or his crew because the 509th Bomb Group came over to Tinian in the summer, like in July of 1945, and they were always practicing bombing on little islands that had been over or bypassed or overlooked. And we kept wondering when they were going to fight and fly combat missions like we did. But even the pilots or crew members in the 509th bomb group didn't know until actually when General Tibbetts was ready to fly on the mission to Hiroshima, he told the crew that they were going to set history. They were going to carry one bomb that was going to maybe end the war. And that's what happened.
And when you came in that day, it had just been dropped, had it not?
Well, it was dropped that day, and coming back, why President Truman had announced that the atomic bomb had been dropped. And so we, and our plane would say, well, what's an atomic bomb? We didn't even know what the word atomic meant, you know. And when we came back to land, there were so many generals and camera people and news media gathered around on the runways that we had to circle around for a little while to before they cleared out and let us land.
If you wish to learn more about B-29s, you may contact Harry Shannon at 408-253-8378. That's 408-253-8378. Captain Shannon, we wish to thank you for coming here and sharing with us some of your most exciting memories of your life as a B-29 pilot.
My pleasure. And if somebody wants to know more, I'd be happy to accommodate.
We do hope you enjoyed the better part and that you will be with us in the weeks to come. If there's a topic you would like to have us consider, if there's a guest you would like to have us feature, if you would like to become part of the group creating this program, please do let us know. You can always reach us through the Cupertino Senior Center. Till then,